These are trivial for me to report, they're trivial for NTFS to report, and some file systems obviously support these but have private interfaces for them. But the ones seem to be very relevant that I wanted to ask, you know, if there are others maybe, are, is this an important file that needs extra integrity checking? I know that there have been talks about BTRFS patches in the past where you'd mark a file rather than a file system as needing enhanced checksums. And then there's the reverse. These files are temp files, we don't need any integrity checking. These are rarely used in like the Windows case, but they're trivial for me to report. And if other file systems have a concept of integrity checking, maybe there's particular files you want to mark, is that a useful flag? It's like a 5 lines of code for me to add, but is it something somebody else would find useful? The other examples that seem to jump out at me in this cloud world is offline. I think other operating systems all have a concept, and I think most network protocols have a concept that you could have a file locally on your laptop, but it's really offline and saved in AWS or saved in Azure or saved in Google Cloud. So don't read that file, right? If you want to read the file, it may take you 5 minutes to download it. So there's an offline flag that's a hint. So like, I don't know if you guys use Macs, but on a Mac, they will read the beginning of a file to bring up its icon. That's a really bad idea if a file has an offline attribute because it could take a long, long time. So trivial for me to report, it's like 5 lines of code for me to report, but is there any other file system that might have a concept of an offline file? Now in Windows, they have 4 additional flags relating to offline that you can use to explain how offline it is and how it's offline, but I think just that flag alone would have value. So I wanted to toss out there the idea, are there any file systems that support offline files? I mean, NFS and SMB, right? But from our perspective, it's like 2 lines of code to like take an attribute that comes off the network protocol and stick it in an attribute flag. So it's trivial for us, but are there any local file systems? NTFS could do this trivially. So anyway, offline, there's also more detail about offline flags you can do if you want. And second, the integrity checking, marking a file that it wants. Whatever you do, file system, do the best you can on integrity checking or the reverse. This is just a temp scratch file, I don't care, don't bother. So those were examples, and there may be other flags you can think of, but I've been thinking it's been a few years since we've extended the StatX flags. Let's extend some more. If you have ideas, let's convince Dave they're worth it.
Minutes, very nice. Any other lightning talk topics that anybody want to throw out here? No? Perfect. I've got one. I'm going to keep myself to 5 minutes because we'll be here all day. So let me reset it. So the roles of maintainers. We're going to have a longer talk about this and like helping, talking about maintainer burnouts and kind of like how we support our maintainers and that sort of thing. Yeah, this week. What?
I didn't know what it was.
Oh, yeah, it's tomorrow, I want to say. It was Derek Wong's slot. He is taking a mental health week, so it is apropos that he was going to talk about this. I will talk about it in his stead and hopefully do it justice for him. But I kind of wanted to talk about how and what maintainers should be doing, right? So, kind of historically, like maintainers are the catch-all. Like they take the patches, they do the review, they do the testing, they do a bunch of different things. And this is, I think, why we tend to burn them out so quickly. They do everything. You got guys that are, and women that are writing code and submitting it or whatever. And then you have, and then they get frustrated because their code doesn't go anywhere because we've got overworked maintainers doing a bunch of things. A lot of different subsystems have kind of addressed this in different ways, rotating maintainers through and that sort of thing. I kind of want to like step back and rethink about how we maintain things in general, because and hold our maintainers accountable to this, not just to like punish them when they're not doing their job, but to like help make sure that they are properly supported. I think the VFS is a really good example of this, and like it is just standard operating procedure for file system developers to send VFS patches out, and if Vero doesn't say anything, we send them through our tree. Like that essentially, like And this ambiguity of like, did Vero see it? Did he not? Did he just see it and doesn't care and therefore it is the green light to go? Like, that kind of ambiguity makes it kind of hard to do work on the VFS layer. And this is an important subsystem, right? And then on the other side of it, you have, how do you deal with maintainers that kind of do everything and how can we support them? And in the ButterFS land, and I know BPF does this, right? Like, there's a lot of patches and there's a lot of review. It's not up to the maintainer to do that patch review, it's up to the developers. And we have it codified in our practices that, like, we rotate the patch review responsibility. I know BPF does it because I copied it from them. So the meta guys all go through and once a week, you know, 1 week I do the patch review, the next week Omar does patch review, and the next week the next guy, and then so on and so forth. And that way, Dave Sturba, the official ButterFS maintainer, he can just sit there and be like, okay, this was reviewed, I can merge it. And then on top of that is testing. I know that it is really, really frustrating to try and like merge stuff and you test it locally and then it merges into the tree and then like the maintainer tests in a different way or you didn't get all the kind of like standard ways to test it and your patch gets kicked out. One of the things that we're trying to do with ButterFS is to like, we have continual integration testing. So that as soon as your patch is merged, that night it gets the full suite of tests run. And that way you can test it locally and make sure it doesn't blow up, but you don't have to worry about all of the random different things that we test. And so as soon as it gets merged, it gets tested. And if it fails, kicks it out. And it's not a big deal, nobody gets mad. It's continual integration testing. And it makes our maintainer's job a lot simpler because he doesn't have to like look at something and be like, wow, this is really hard. I hope we don't break anything and like delay merging it. No, he can be like, okay, this looks cool. We can merge it. It gets tested. If it fails, great. We kick it out, report it to the patch submitter. They can change the things. And it closes the loop a lot faster and you can kind of do this. And I think this is a really good way to like kind of offload the responsibility of the maintainer. Because in the end, what I want from the maintainer is to make the decision when there's a conflict. Like if there is competing ideas from multiple developers in the same community, like that's where I want the maintainer to be spending their energy because the maintainer has the most context about what's all going on because they're the ones that are merging the code. And I would love to see us move away from the maintainer that just kind of like sits there and merges stuff or whatever and kind of like doesn't get involved, but rather is more actively involved in, you know, not only setting the direction, but like helping developers come to a common understanding. And I'm done. So, yeah. Lots of stuff. But anyway, I'm out of time. Does anybody else have any other anything else they want to talk about or any comments they want to?
Steve.
Microphone.
So as a maintainer, many of these frustrations every maintainer has, but the number one thing that I think about is that there's got to be some, like when Ted gave that example of how to automate XFS tests for EXT4, every single developer in the room had some benefit they could draw from that. From my perspective, what I keep thinking is I can mirror trees to GitHub or GitLab or whatever, and there's got to be somebody who's smarter, who's figured out how to do actions inside GitHub, GitLab, or whatever, to run sparse, to run check patch, to run these, you know, like, why is it that I've not found a single tree that automated the kinds of boring things that waste maintainers' time? So I'm hoping somebody's done it.
So, sorry. This is the direction that I'm taking ButterFS. Right now, I built a lot of that scaffolding myself, that like all the continual integration stuff just exists in scripts. I've been working with Lewis on KDevOps to move my crappy scripts or whatever to do this thing. The next step is to tie that into GitHub Actions. So not only we'll have the continual integration testing of our main branch, but then developers can just push branches and then get the same testing that they'll get when it gets merged. and they can know before they even send us patches that, oh yeah, my stuff works fine. There's no, I didn't break anything.
This reminds me in Samba, I don't do a lot for Samba anymore, but Samba, you know, whenever a developer would do a check-in, it would automatically kick off a regression test and do all this kind of stuff, and it wouldn't even get to the point of asking for a merge into the official branch, you know, that the temporary merge would cause all this to happen.
Yep.
And it saves so much time for Samba developers to have all of this offloaded in scripts.
Yeah, like this is kind of what the in the back. The get a microphone, dude.
Okay. We actually have all these actions implemented for BPF, and we're running them.
Yeah, I think that BPF, again, I steal a lot of your guys' ideas because they're fucking great. And this is kind of, you know, BPF is a little bit easier to test than, you know, XFS tests, right? But this is kind of like, I am saying this out loud in front of a bunch of maintainers so we can all be thinking about this, because I never really thought about it because I know how to run XFS tests locally. But it wasn't until I had to like onboard new guys that it's like, hey, go run XFS tests. And like 3 days later, they're like, yeah, I still can't get this thing to work. I was like, that's like a 3 days waste of time, right? Like if I just say, hey, run make test and KDevOps, and I don't have to think about it again, then, oh God, save me so much.
Or figure out how to set up a baseline and then figure out which tests are expected to fail given the current state of the tree and so on. This is really a big problem, especially if you have to run XFS tests for a file system with, I don't know, different mount options, for example.
Right, so this is one of the things that I did. This is why I did it, is because I needed to know the baseline. And so I have, with the continual integration, I have the baseline, and then I go and I figured out all the tests that were failing that weren't supposed to be failing, fixed XFS tests. And like, we have this kind of built-in mentality of like, oh yeah, these things fail. And this is hard to describe to new people. It's like, what, you expect things to fail? Then why are you even testing it? Well, it's just the way we've always done it. The way we've always done it sucks. So I would really love to, yeah, thanks, Willie.
I mean,
I want to change this attitude to get towards this place where our testing and all of our things that we do are a lot easier to do, because then it makes it easier for us to have new developers, but it makes it so much easier on our maintainers, because the maintainers don't have to fret and worry and stress out about whether or not this thing broke, because we have all of these automated things in place and all of these things in place, and like reviewing and testing and all of this stuff, and that way all they have to worry about is, okay, this has been here for a while and it works, and it was reviewed, and then they have to like manage conflicts or manage cross areas.
I mean, there is a file system specific aspect to this, but there is also a VFS aspect to this. We sometimes simply also, even if you invest a lot of time in reviewing patches and trying to help people along, and then we often don't have tests for various things that are security relevant. And so it's sometimes really unclear what the intended semantics are. And if you start to write tests, then suddenly you realize.
Yeah, so Butterfist has had a long-standing requirement that if you're adding any sort of feature or whatever, that you write an XFS test, because I'm not, like, as the reviewer, I'm not able to think about, I'm not a machine, I can't like reason out what's going to happen. I need to have a test so that when I review it, or as a maintainer, when I merge it, I know it's working, and when other people change it, I know it didn't break. And like, these are kind of like, you say them out loud and you're like, oh yeah, duh. But like, we don't do this generally. And I think that things like VFS is a really good example of this. We're adding new interfaces or whatever, it should be thoroughly tested in an XFS test before it's merged.
I think to give credit where credit is due, that actually is one of the things that folks like Christoph and Dave Chinner are actually pretty good at, which is anything which is adding a core VFS feature, they're one of the first ones to say, where's the XFS tests?
Yeah.
You know, the other thing I'll say is a lot of the work that I did with KVM XFS tests and GCE XFS tests was so I could scale, right? I've brought up new people, you know, I've been onboarding some new junior engineers, and it's so much easier when you have a test suite which is easy to run with a pre-built test appliance.
Yep.
I think folks who haven't actually tried to start up using XFS tests from scratch very often has forgotten how hard it is to set up XFS tests,
yep.
Right? And I think, you know, so I think, you know, Louise and I both have our own test runners, and the more we can encourage people to use an existing test runner if you don't want to write your own, it really, really helps.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I'm not saying this like we're all doing a terrible job.
Yes.
Like, we are all in pockets doing great stuff. Like, I used your KVM XFS test really early on, like years and years ago, right? And like, these are all really good ideas, but what I see is like, we end up, like, pockets of us are doing good things, and some of us are doing some of them, and some of us are doing different things, and I would love it if we could all as a community talk about these things and do better, and kind of help, just because this helps everybody. This helps new people get up on board and get going faster. It helps the maintainers. It helps the developers merge stuff quicker because we can have higher confidence that we're not breaking anything. And it helps the maintainers focus on the important things, keeping track of the big picture, what new features are coming in, and helping to moderate when we have developer disagreements, right? And helping to pick a path forward. A lot of times I see things where we have like a really big blow up and you have two strong developers arguing on one side and there's no progress towards a real solution. And this is what I want the maintainer role to do, is to come in and say, okay, this is what we're gonna do. You're gonna do this and you're gonna do this and this is the way forward. And
a third person stepping in and essentially saying, calm down.
Yeah. Exactly.
This is not happening at all,
right,
currently.
So one thing I wanted to emphasize is, I think you said in the BTRFS community, certainly there may be a few where it's expected, when, you know, obviously Christoph and others are good about this too, when you do a feature, when you do certain types of fixes, you're expected to add a test case. I think, you know, I'm looking at like my example as a maintainer, 300 patches, 300 change sets, maybe 10 test cases were added.
Right.
Maybe a little bit more, but about 10 per year. So that's not a really good ratio, 1 out of 30. By contrast, take Samba, right? They're pretty strict. If something, I mean, obviously there's some things that there really isn't a good test case to do, but in many cases you can. So they were very, very good about, you know, if you added some feature, they would encourage, almost require a test case. And I think it varies a lot by community, but if the expectation is not just the BTRFS team does it, but the EXT4 team, the XFS team, the NFS team, the SMB team, this is gonna change everything for a maintainer in a good way. Because, like, we do a terrible job of putting in regression tests compared to some other projects, and I think we could do a lot more.
Yeah, I don't want to bag on people, because I think in general, the file system community does a really good job with test coverage. It's more about actually running the stupid things consistently, right? Running them and making sure that everything is working. We have I know that historically maintainers do it. Like, I know Ted does it like all the time. And what I want to do is move towards this thing where that's easier. It's easier to run the tests. It's done in a consistent way, and it's done in a more automated way, so Ted doesn't have to sit there and do it, it just happens. And then maybe Ted doesn't just have to do it, like you can just push somewhere, and a developer gets results before they even go to Ted or me or Jenner or whatever.
I think something else that's probably worth talking about, and again, maybe this is just spilling over to tomorrow's XFS test talk, is sometimes I need to run, for example, NFS test, because I'm actually trying to debug an NFS problem, and I don't necessarily know what tests are expected to pass or fail for NFS, because NFS is special and XFS test is generic.
Yeah.
And so somewhere there's a wiki page that I found which said these are the tests that are expected to pass and these are the tests that don't. And I hope it's up to date.
It's
I used it. It mostly seemed to work, right? But that's actually one of the areas where I suspect we could collaborate, right?
Yeah, that,
is,
that
you know, how do we communicate amongst ourselves? If somebody other than me wants to run EXT4 tests, how do they know which tests to exclude? Because the tests are buggy, and it's a lot faster for me to exclude the test than to fix the test to understand EXT4 cluster allocation, right? Which the XFS tests don't do, so I just exclude some tests.
That, yeah.
But unless you use my test runner, you won't know that.
That's what I meant by the baseline. That's the thing. I spent 1.5 weeks or about 2 weeks talking to him because he was knowledgeable in the file system that I was touching and constantly asked, is this test expected to fail? Is this test expected to fail? And because it's a file system that's on top of other file systems, I had to test 4 underlying file systems. It drove me crazy.
Yeah, and like,
but I literally spent 2 weeks doing this.
Yeah, and I spent a month. Like, I just, it fucking drove me nuts. And, like, I had all this data. I have a year of continual integration testing.
COC.
So, like, okay, I know exactly what fails all of the time. And I went down and I've tracked down every single one of them. I fixed them or I disabled them.
So with KDevOps, what Lewis is doing is he's basically maintaining an expansion list as well.
Yeah.
So anything which fails gets added to the expansion list, as in anything which fails and he thinks is not, should be excluded, goes into the expansion list. And that is how we kind of have a baseline against which we can check.
Yeah.
So,
I think that's a good solution. I like my, that's a great solution. Let's not say his is a bad solution, but I spent the time to get us down to 0 failures. ButterFS should not fail at all, ever. If it is, then we have a problem. Because that's a lot easier to explain to a new person than, oh yeah, go check this exclude list. We expected these ones to fail, but why the fuck are they in there still?
But there's a lot of flaky tests, at least on XFS. I've been spending a lot of time running XFS tests with failures, and there's, you know, if the phase of the moon is right, then this test is going to fail.
Yeah.
Generic /270.
So I think that flaky tests just, we take them out of the auto group. What I should say is I want the auto group to always pass. So I think if you run check -g auto, which is the normal set of tests, like those tests should always pass. I think there's a place for the flaky ones that are like stress tests or whatever to, like, you know, make sure the thing doesn't explode, right? I think that's a great, great thing. But like general, like I'm testing to make sure I didn't regress anything. Nothing should fail.
What about adding, if you are worried about, you know, what tests to be run, adding that to the maintainers file, at least having, you know, this subsystem, here's the test that you should run, or at least a link to something that says here's where you should go and has all the, like a wiki or something,
yeah,
to do that. And I guess someone also mentioned about, you know, setting up tests may be difficult. Perhaps you could have some sort of repository of like VMs that actually say, here, download this VM, load your code to it, or boot your kernel with this VM, have some instructions on doing QEMU, and go run your tests. And at least that way they don't you know, ruin their file system if they did something wrong. And then that VM would have the file system that'd be testing.
Yeah, so like that is what I'm moving towards with the KDevOps stuff, is that I literally just have a wiki page that says install KDevOps, run this, because I have configuration stuff in KDevOps to point at the ButterFS tree with the ButterFS progs with all the configs that you need, and then you can just run it and it does everything like I do in my setup. Like, and that's the ultimate goal, right? Is to make it as easy as possible for random developers to wander in and test and make sure they didn't break anything.
The other thing we saw needs to do with XFS tests is document much better how to actually write tests. Because I had to add some thick tests to it and went in the documentation direction. There was a README file saying someone should add some documentation.
Yep.
So I added some documentation. I've noticed some people have extended the documentation, but other people have added feature things and haven't bothered to add them to the documentation. So adding new tests also needs to come with documentation requirements, or at least adding new library things for testing things needs to come with a documentation requirement. So
yep,
just people can work out how to write tests.
Definitely.
One thing to note here is that half the problem sometimes is fixing XFS tests is hard, right? So,
yeah.
You know, we were testing XFS and
XFS and some of the non-standard configs, like if you're using the real-time config with a, you know, 28K real-time config thing, like blows up on the standard XFS tests. Now, if you take Derek's XFS tree, he has like several hundred patches, not all of which he's managed to get upstream. And if you cherry pick the right fixes from his XFS test config, then the real-time XFS config will actually pass mostly, right? And so that's actually half the problem. Like for EXT4, the default 4K thing, we're actually pretty good. But for some of the more exotic configs, figuring out how to actually make generic XFS tests pass for some of the more exotic file system configs, like XFS real-time, like EXT4 Big Alloc, which is a clustered allocation system, is actually not trivial. And a lot of it is, again, you know, maintainer bandwidth, right? I spent a whole day looking at all of the flaky tests and all the test failures and figuring out how do I clear some of the test failures from the more exotic EXT4 cases, right? But I'm the only one doing that.
Right.
And, you know, help is needed. I think if there are people who want to help their file systems, you know, get XFS tests to be clean, don't wait for the maintainers to actually get the tests clean. Help them clean the tests.
Yeah, one thing I wanted to do that's related to that is, some time ago I tried to add an FS info system call, so you could actually query quite a lot of information about the capabilities of the file system, what it supports, what it doesn't support, what its limitations are, because I thought we can take that and we can feed that information into XFS test to say, this is what the file system should be able to do.
Yeah.
So it helped key which tests you need to run, and or are there not so much which one you need to run, which ones should fail, because this feature is not supported, or is not applicable in some way.
Right. Yeah. I think we're wandering off into the XFS test weeds a little bit, and half third of the room does not give a shit. So there's a lot of good work here. I just kind of wanted to raise awareness about like the different things the different communities are doing, and what I envision a really good way to kind of solve the problem of maintainer burnout is to kind of offload a lot of the things that maintainers do, automate the testing, distribute the review stuff, and free up maintainers to do more of the vision and moderating and arbitration work. So with that being said, it is 5:39. We have dinner at 6 o'clock over there. It's literally right down the road, like right down the pathway here. It's the Oasis, I wanna say. You can find it on the maps around the resort. Go drop your stuff off. Come back here around 6. We're all going to have dinner. It's been a great first day. Also, I meant to say this in the beginning, and I didn't because I didn't write anything down. The Linux Foundation has been fantastic. They set up, they did all of the stuff for the virtual things. I've been working with them for 3 years. They go through and they sign the contracts and they get the hotel set up and then we cancel. So they did all of, like, as much work as I did, it is pales in comparison to what the Linux Foundation did to do this every single year. They got contracts like signed and AV people set up and all of that every year and that we had to cancel, and then got it working again this year. So they did a wonderful job. So round of applause for Linux Foundation. All right, see everybody at dinner.